So when Jyoti called me and said, will you speak on IIH without papilledema? I said, it doesn't interest me because invariably they do well. And I said, we should be more worried about patients with IIH who do not have headache. Okay, but and it was Providence. And I said, I have not seen too many patients with IIH and papilledema. We have a big patient load with IIH and CVT with papilledema. We see almost 2 to 3 new cases every day and quite a few follow-ups in our neuro-ophthal clinic. So it was just Providence that the same afternoon, there was this patient who presented, a 42-year-old male, who presented with complaints of headache of 20 days duration, nausea, vomiting, and diplopia of 10 days duration. And this patient was worked up in NIMHANS, the National Institute of Mental Health, and referred to us for visual assessment. So his best corrected visual acuity in both eyes was 6x6 and 6, normal color vision. Anterior segment was normal, and funduscopy was this, normal fundus, no papilledema. But as Dr. Jyoti was saying earlier, we never take a normal looking disc or an atrophic disc at its face value. We always do B scan and measure the optic nerve sheath diameter. So we did that also. Okay, I'll come to that. And continuing with the clinical examination, the patient had a mild esotropia and there was bilateral restriction of abduction. Okay, pointing towards bilateral sixth nerve palsy. And we did the B scan and it only measured 2.85 millimeters on both sides. We also did the visual field analysis, which was normal. We also got the MRI brain report, which read normal. They had done MRI and MRV, so there was no evidence of any venous occlusions. We also got this report from NIMHANS. The opening pressures were 350 millimeters of water, and the CSF biochemistry and the cellular contents were normal. So with that, the diagnosis is IIH without papilledema. So it does exist. And in fact, if you check literature, so it actually, thanks to Jyoti, that I actually went back and looked in detail at this condition. And it does have an acronym, IIHWOP, idiopathic intracranial hypertension without papilledema. And there is intracranial idiopathic hypertension with papilledema. So there's IIHWOP, IIHWP. And it is a recognized condition by the International Headache Society for Classification of Headache Disorders. And it does occur in 8 to 10% of patients with IIH. And the clinical characteristics almost are similar, IIHWOP and IIHWP. So what are those clinical characteristics? So if you look at for the diagnosis of IIH, we have to follow the modified Dandy's criteria, which all of us are familiar. So signs and symptoms of raised ICP, headache and papilledema, no localizing neurological signs, normal CT or MRI, increase documented opening pressure greater than 250 millimeters of water, normal CSF contents, an awake and alert patient, and no other causes of raised ICP detected both on examination, investigations, and on detailed history. It was then modified by Friedman and Jacobson, who said that just an MRI is enough in a typical patient. The typical patient is an obese female patient in the childbearing age group. And we definitely need to do an MRI with an MR venography in patients who are atypical. That includes children and males. More recent modification, as described by Degre et al., was that the sign could be absent. The sign which could be absent is papilledema. And that's when this new terminology came in, IIHWOP and IIHWP. So how is this possible? So how can you have raised ICP with no papilledema? Okay, there is evidence in literature that even in patients with documented SONs, space occupying lesion, with infections and documented raised ICP do not manifest papilledema. In fact, Hayre, who we are all very proud of, in his classical study on rhesus monkeys, where he raised the intraocular pressures by inflating a balloon, found that there was no papilledema in, found papilledema only in 29 out of 32 monkeys. So the remaining three monkeys did not manifest papilledema despite the balloons being inflated and the pressures being high, intracranial pressures being high. So IIHWOP goes back to 1972, which was described by Lipton. And subsequently, there are a few case reports and there are two case series, but not too much of attention has been given to it. So how is it possible? So one is that we do know that raised ICP can occur without papilledema because of evidence in literature, and we have also seen it. And we also are aware the other evidence is the presence of asymmetric papilledema. That's an indirect evidence that it is possible to have raised ICP and not have papilledema in one nerve when you compare it with the other nerve. And for that, I'll briefly describe this patient who presented to us with severe headache. More than the headache, it was the decreased vision. She kept saying that there is something wrong with my vision. I'm not comfortable. And this was the disc finding. And perimetry showed this visual field constriction in both eyes, but not so much in the right eye. Then the eye with the papilledema was more affected. And the MRI was done, and an opening pressure was measured, and a diagnosis of IIH was established, and the patient was started on oral acetazolamide. She's been on follow-up with me for the past 3 months, and this is her latest visual fields. And the papilledema is slowly reducing. And this is another patient where we have papilledema being present in both eyes. However, the visual loss is more in one eye compared to the other eye. And this patient, this was her visual fields when she presented to me with decreased vision in one eye. She was referred from elsewhere. And post-ONSD in the affected eye, the visual field marginally improved, and we retained the visual, and she maintained visual function in the right eye. So there is evidence, that indirect evidence, that this is possible. And the other, and so what is the level at which these things can happen? Hayre says that most of the canalicular part of the optic nerve, that is the point at which most of this transmittance of pressure occurs. And the other evidence is that in inflammatory conditions like meningitis, there could be fibrous adhesion. So it could be an acquired closure of the optic nerve sheath canal. And also there's other evidence saying that there is fluctuating CSF pressure. So sometimes at the time when we are examining the patient, it may be possible that there's no papilledema and the CSF pressure is low. But in another time, the pressures may be going up, and we may be looking at the pressures going up when still papilledema is still setting in. So we need to carefully examine these patients. Clinical characteristics, as I said, is common both for IIH, WOP and with papilledema. Headache, typical headache in obese female patients with pulsatile tinnitus, projectile vomiting, and transient visual obscurations are common. So what are the differences? How will you identify this condition from the other? It is said that the presence of aura and migraine-like symptoms are more common in patients without papilledema. There is less involvement of the sixth nerve, but however, in the case which I presented in the beginning, the patient had bilateral sixth nerve. There is a history of vertigo. And on follow-up, in a series by Wang et al., normal visual outcomes were more likely in patients without papilledema than in patients with papilledema. And patients with papilledema definitely showed a higher opening CSF pressure. They're more likely to have visual field loss, and so they were more likely to undergo optic nerve sheath fenestration. So the treatment is the same for both conditions, except that CSF shunting procedures for severe not responding headaches are more likely in patients with without papilledema, while optic nerve sheath fenestration is more likely in the other group of patients. So to conclude, IIH without papilledema does exist, and high index of suspicion, especially in patients prone to have, that is a female patient who's obese or overweight, who's in the childbearing age, who's got chronic headache, one should suspect IIH without papilledema. Treatment is like typical IIH, and vision loss is unlikely, so you could space your, I mean, space the follow-up schedules more at a longer distance. Thank you.